This is the third episode in the Common Ancestry series. In the first video, we saw the history of evolutionary theory and learned that the theory of common ancestry is testable. In the second video, we looked at a number of vertebrate common ancestors from the common ancestor of all humans to our common ancestor with all tetrapods. Then, new kinds took over, taking us through fish evolution, dropping us off with the earliest vertebrates. That's where we start now. We start the phylogenetics of new kinds with early vertebrates, hailing from the Cambrian, such as Hycoichthys. Our most recent common ancestor with lampreys and hagfish, collected into a clade called Cyclostomata, lived around 525 million years ago, and that ancestor was a jawless, finless fish. Now that joins together all vertebrates. Pushing closer to the start of the Cambrian, at 535 million years ago, was our common ancestor with tunicates, which are soft-bodied filter feeders. Tunicate larvae are motile and tadpole-like, but become either sessile or free-floating as they grow. As such, biologists theorize that the earliest chordates had tadpole-like larvae, and that vertebrates arose due to pedomorphosis, which is when traits of juveniles are retained into adulthood. In this case, the morphology of the tunicate larvae was retained, which is indicated by fossils of early vertebrates. We also see it in animals closely related to tunicates, such as Hycuella. Along with tunicates, all animals now form the clade Olfactores. The last chordates joined the pack at 540 million years ago, known as Cephalochordata. Modern cephalochordates are the tiny lancelets, but the Cambrian Pacaya and Cathaymyris are also members of this group. Zongzoniscus is a possible cephalochordate, but is especially interesting in that it has S-shaped myomers, blocks of skeletal muscle tissue, like cephalochordates, while also having fin rays, like early vertebrates, making paleontologists place it as an intermediate between Cathaymyris and Hycoichthys. Some of the earliest chordates were worm-like animals, such as Didozoan. Chordata is a phylum within the clade Deuterostomia. Deuterostomes are all animals that develop their anus before their mouth embryonically, and the only living non-chordate deuterostomes are grouped within a clade called Ambulacraria, including echinoderms and hemichordates. Echinoderms are starfish, brittle stars, sea lilies, sand dollars, sea urchins, etc. And hemichordates are acorn worms, pterobranchs, and graptolites. Echinoderms possess bilaterally symmetrical larvae, but they develop radial symmetry as they grow, which is evidently an adaptation to a sessile lifestyle. Amazingly, a group of Cambrian echinoderms has been discovered, called the Vitulocystids. Hemichordates, on the other hand, are intriguing in that they have some traits of chordates, even though they are not chordates themselves. The New World Encyclopedia says, quote, "Acorn worms are considered more highly specialized and advanced than other similarly shaped worm-like creatures. They have a circulatory system with a heart that also functions as a kidney. Acorn worms have gill-like structures that they use for breathing, similar to the gills of primitive fish. Hence, acorn worms are sometimes said to be a link between classical invertebrates and vertebrates. Some also have a post-anal tail that sometimes shows weak signs of segmentation. An interesting trait is that its three-section body plan is not present in the vertebrates, except from the anatomy of the frontal neural tube, later developed into a brain that is divided into three main parts. This means some of the original anatomy of the early chordate ancestors may still be present even if it is not always visible." Close quote. Similarly, the 2015 paper, Hemichordate Genomes and Deuterostome Origins, notes a number of similarities that hemichordates share with more derived deuterostomes as well as genes that were probably present in the common ancestor of all deuterostomes. And, even more interestingly, hemichordates have certain genes organized more like protostomes than deuterostomes. Protostomes develop their mouth before their anus embryonically, which is precisely the opposite of deuterostomes. Now, what about those genes? In deuterostomes, we have genes called cordin and BMP that pattern our dorsoventral development. Protostomes have homologs of these called SOG and DPP, respectively. Cordin is expressed on our dorsal side, while BMP is expressed on our ventral side. Like the development of the mouth and anus, the homologs of these genes in protostomes develop oppositely. The homolog of chordin develops ventrally and BMP dorsally. Hemichordates, like protostomes, express their chordin ventrally and their BMP dorsally. This means that the protostome development of chordin and BMP is the ancestral state, and that a dorsoventral inversion occurred in the evolution of deuterostomes. The ciliated, bilaterally symmetrical diplerula larvae of echinoderms is hypothesized to have been the ancestor of all deuterostomes. And recently, a very early bag-like Cambrian deuterostome was discovered named Saccharitis. The ancestor of all deuterostomes was probably a worm-like, bilaterally symmetrical animal, though. We share a common ancestor with protostomes at 560 million years ago, finally pushing us into the Precambrian. Protostomia encompasses a huge group of bilaterally symmetrical animals and is mostly comprised of two clades called Lophotrochozoa and Ecdysozoa. The former is comprised of rotifers, flatworms, segmented worms, mollusks, etc. And the latter is comprised of penis worms, roundworms, tardigrades, velvet worms, and arthropods. Basal to both groups is a clade commonly called arrowworms, or technically Catignatha, which are intriguing because they partly develop like a deuterostome. Thus, we see there are deuterostomes that develop like protostomes, such as hemichordates, and protostomes that develop like deuterostomes, such as arrowworms. As it happens, there's a group of bilaterians that aren't classified as either protostomes or deuterostomes, the acoelomate flatworms. They joined the pack at 570 million years ago, and their phylogenetic placement has been hotly debated in the past. However, researchers have reached a consensus, as documented by the 2004 paper, The Dawn of Bilaterian Animals, The Case of Acoelomorph Flatworms, and the 2016 paper, Xenoacoelomorpha is the sister group to Nephrozoa. This placement of the acoelomate flatworms has affected how biologists understand the last common ancestor of all bilaterally symmetrical animals, called the Urbilaterian. Biologists previously reasoned that the Urbilaterian was coelomate and that acoelomate flatworms were protostomes that had secondarily lost their coelom. Now it would appear that the Urbilaterian was a segmented acoelomate animal. We'll discuss how the Urbilaterian arose in the next video. So, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.